So welcome to Spirits Studio, and I am Shalini Kumar, today your host for the town hall program for the Spirits Studio, and we are with the top names of India in mixology. So welcome you all, and we have Yangdup with us, everybody knows he is a celebrity bartender and also co-owner of Delhi NCR's bars, Sidecar and Cocktail and Dreams. Welcome, Yangdup. And then Rohan Carvalho. He is a very, very famous flair bartender and contributed a lot to the flair bartending industry. And also co-owner, partner at Bar Square India. Am I right, Rohan?
That's right, ma'am.
Okay. And then we have Shadbi, Shadbi Basu. And she is India's first lady bartender and makes lovely cocktails, a very famous mixologist. And then we have Arijit Bose. Arijit is, somebody told me, and I also know that he is globally renowned bartender. And I met Arijit, I still remember, in 2009 when I think Harinath had won the competition.
The Bacardi competition, 2011.
Okay, and you did something at somewhere in Saket or... Harinath, right.
Yeah.
And that time I met and I became a fan of him instantly. So welcome, Arijit. And now Sandy is also online with us. Welcome, Sandy. Sandy is a famous bartender, of course. But at the same time, he has converted bartending trade in a fine art of business. So that's, we have a lot to learn from Sandy, and welcome, Sandeep Verma. So he is very well known by the pet name Sandy. So all of us call him Sandy. So welcome you all at Spirits Studio. And now, as you, all of you know that this is a kind of a situation, COVID-19, this is unprecedented sort of. So nobody knows what to do, what we should follow about it. Ki something had happened before and we can follow that. Ki we can take these kind of precautions and we can come out with some of the solutions. It's not the case. So let's start with Yangdup, right? So Yangdup, and I think except Arijit, I don't know about, everybody has his own bartending school. Am I right? In some way or the other.
That's true.
Right? Arijit, true.
Which means Arijit is still learning.
He's still a student. Right.
Actually, Arijit is providing us with a boost to use.
So
I think the closest I came to teaching was IHM Dada Catering, IHM Bombay for a bit, okay. About a year. That was it.
Okay.
It's too much work teaching other people.
I know. So you people are doing commendable job for the community. And I appreciate that. And I always appreciate that. So Yangdup, you tell me that you have a school. And so right now it's closed. You have two bars where consumers come. They are also closed right now. So... in this time, I have heard a lot of a story. I think Rohan will second me on that, that people are stuck somewhere they are working in, at their houses. They are not with their family. They were not able to fly or take a train to their native places. So they are not with their family. So they are right now in a very, very depressing situation. So how do you think you can help them out to be out from this kind of a depressing situation?
Yes, Shalini, thank you for the introduction. And to straight away answer your question. And I think the first and the foremost is, you know, since, like you said earlier, this is the first time a situation like this has occurred, I think it's very difficult to say that this is the way one should approach. So it's very difficult. You know, there isn't a single solution for, because different people are in different situations. Yes. Whether it is a bartender, whether it is a server, whether it is people staying with their family or without the family. So different people are in different situations. Okay. So there isn't a one standard solution for any of these. But the first and the foremost for every person in every situation is to be mentally sorted. So the most important thing is to make sure that you are mentally sorted in your head. You know, that's very important. Now, how do you do it? That's the second question. It's easy to say that you got to come, stay calm, stay safe, but how do you approach that? You know, that's very important. So I was just talking to, you know, we keep having this Zoom trainings between 2 and 4 every day for both, all the three teams from a bar school, from the both the bars, including the managers, servers, bartenders. And we discuss on various subjects, right? Apart from beverages. And, you know, we try crack and joke, try and, you know, groom them and give them trainings on different aspects of becoming a better professional. But, you know, the other day when I was speaking to one of my managers, he said, I'm really, really bored. And I'm not, you know, I kind of get disinterested in everything that I do presently. And I said, why does that happen? Because, and then he said, you know, I'm used to traveling. I love to travel. I am not the kind of person who likes to stay at home. And here I am, it's been a month that I'm inside the house and I don't know what to do. So now how do you give an answer to that question? Because the first and the foremost thing is that your movement is restricted, right? So it's very difficult. So I told him, I said, you know, the only thing that I could probably help you and what has worked for me is, I said, if possible, close your eyes for 10 minutes and just be yourself. Disconnect from everything, you know, and just with a cool, calm mind, just concentrate. I would not say meditate, but I would just say, just disconnect from everything for a moment and just think who you are. Try and discover yourself and find a solution for yourself, because only you, we can from a distance, we can only suggest, but it's only you. So the person who is in that situation, only he or she can figure out a way. And the first approach to figure out the right perspective and to understand how to deal with it is to be able to discover yourself. So I would suggest that everybody should first and the foremost, you know, just disconnect from everything, whether it's social media, whether it's telephones, internet, all of that. Stay calm, you know, try and just get your mind into one thing, you know. So nothing doing, you know, like it's not about trying to connect with anybody else, but for 10, 15 minutes, just disconnect and be yourself. And then see how you could use your time and how you could probably cope with whatever situation you are in. You know, if it is a financial constraint or if it is a situation where, you know, you're not getting a salary or you are in a difficult situation getting your food supplies, you can still, you know, people can still help, like everybody can still help. But if it is a mental situation, then it becomes very difficult, because unless you yourself are in that situation, like if there is something going on in my mind, unless somebody else is in a similar situation, it's very difficult to figure out and find a solution. So in a situation like this, it is the person, he himself, you know, and it's tough. It's not easy. It's very tough, but that's the only way out for the moment, you know, because, you know, physically we cannot meet anyone. So it's going to be tough. So that is the only, and probably the only and the first, and from my side, I think that's the first approach, to find a suitable solution and then see where to approach.
Thank you, Amdo. Let's go to Shadbi. Shadbi, I think, Rohan, you are based out of Bangalore, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And Yangdop, Sandy, and I, we are from Delhi NCR. So, yeah, Shadbi,
me and Sandy is 100 meters away.
100 meters, sir. I am far more. So,
Arijit, why is your volume on mute, Baba? Arijit's volume is off. Your sound is off.
And now it's.
I'm keeping it mute so I can hear everybody.
Okay. Okay. So, Shadbhi.
Yes, I'll.
Go ahead, Arijit. What were you saying?
I'm listening. I'm here.
Okay. So, Shadbhi.
As soon as something nice to say, I'll.
So, you are from the industrial city of India, Mumbai, which has the largest cases of COVID-19. And I think everyone is doing their bit to control this pandemic. But till now, I think we have found that we have flattened the curve, not the going down, but at least flattened the curve. But WHO says that we have yet to hit by the second wave of COVID-19. So let's see for that. So Shadbhi, you tell me, you have lot to do with the students, right? And you have lot of work to do with the different bars. You have created lots of menu for other bars and restaurants. And so what do you do in this time of lockdown? How do you communicate with your students and with other community? And what are you doing? How are you educating them to live without stress?
Well, we talk to them often as we can. I try and, a lot of times when they call up, I explain to them that the most important thing in my mind is to accept. Instead of simply saying I'm bored, first accept that this is a situation that all of us are in. You're not the only one. It's not happening only to you. It's happening to each one of us. So once you accept that this is not going anywhere for a while, then you can actually then start beginning to see and beginning to understand what you can do with yourself. I think, it's very important to understand that we are not unidimensional. As human beings, as social beings, we are not unidimensional. We have more than one dimension. It's just that because we have been working in one particular focus area, we've never really looked beyond that focus area to see who else we are. And so I think this is a really good time to introspect a little bit and to discover who we are as people and to see what else we can do apart from that one focus area that we monotonously work with, because, that's who we are. That's our job. So I think this is a great time to find out who we are apart from bartenders. Can we do other things? We have so many different things that we like, our hobbies. And is there any one hobby or even five hobbies that we can recreate at this point of time? It's a great time to look at those things and to find different things to do. Talk. We are able to communicate. And that's a great thing that the internet is actually helping us. And that we have been able to communicate with other people. We've lost touch with so many people. It's a great time to communicate. It's a great time to find friends. It's a great time to be able to discuss this aspect with other friends. And I think when you do that, you can find that there's more to life than just the one thing that we are used to. We can actually, I know a lot of people are taking to cooking. They never knew that they could cook, but they are now actually able to do that. And I think that's great. There are people who are doing word puzzles and are actually doing word wars with friends. So that's a great way to occupy one's mind and to, do different things. People are discussing gardening. People are discussing plants on their windows. So I think there's so many things that we can actually do, but we don't, because we are unilateral in the way we think that this is our job and this is the only thing we know. Actually, there's a lot in our minds that we haven't discovered. And for me, I think that's what I encourage them to do. I encourage them to discover themselves, to find new things and new avenues. And in this quiet, when our mind is actually uncluttered with the chores of daily life, I think it is an opportunity to discover new things. And I'm always there for them. I always tell them that if there's something that's on your mind and you want to discuss it, give me a call and we'll talk about it. We'll find a way to fine-tune what you are thinking about and see how you can utilize that, not just today while we are locked in, but how you can utilize that post-locked in, post-COVID as well. Because that might be an opportunity to do something new.
Right. Thank you, Radhmi. Very nicely put. Very nicely put. So now, Rohan, I come to you.
Yes, ma'am.
So you have been doing, and I think Spritz is a media partner with that also. You have been doing Indian Flairology competition. Yeah, Flair Bartender Association and Flairology Bartending competition. You have been doing since last 1.5 years. And it's been doing really well. So, but this is the time when you can't do anything on ground. So, how are you dealing with that situation and how are you helping those flair bartenders in this difficult time?
Yeah. So, when we started off the Indian Flair Bartenders Association, that was the passion driven. We wanted to come, it was totally passion driven and it was the motive for this was to basically support bartenders who aren't getting support from, you know, any sources and bartenders who basically like to flair. Because I once upon a time, you know, whatever I am today is also because of flair, I would say that. So flair bartending wanted a little bit of push and that is how IFBA started off. Well, coming to today's situation as we talk, we all know that what dire situation we are all in and we do not know what the future is going to hold. So organizing competition, which was a primary motive, has been kept on hold until further notice. So the entire IFBA members, we thought about, you know, what do we do right now? Because we formed this to kind of also help people, help the bartending fraternity indeed. So we came up with this idea about, you know, we had collected some funds with whatever we, the competitions that we did last year. And we had some funds in our account. We thought of kind of, you know, giving back to people who actually need the funds. Because we know that I would say that this entire industry could be divided into various parts. There are bartenders who are in a situation that they can hold themselves together and get over it by deflecting the attention from the scene that is happening now. And there is a segment of people that cannot because they are in a situation which was already not so good because of the kind of dependence they have in their family. And given the scenario today, they are in a total depression mood. So we thought of let's reach out to people who don't have a voice. So we started off this campaign called IFBA Support the Bartender and the F&B Industry. And we started off this Google form wherein anybody who needed help could kind of log in and share their problems. And we would transfer some amount into their account. So we wanted to cater to a larger audience in terms of not only bartenders, but also people like housekeepers, people like dishwashers, servers, hostesses, all of these guys who, I mean, there's no community as such, I feel, which could kind of hear them out. So we tried to reach out to everybody. And we have been successful because the queries that came to us, people that reached out to us were in a huge number. And little did we know that there are some people who are in a very depression mode in 2 weeks after the lockdown was announced. And this lockdown has extended and we do not know when this lockdown is going to close. It's going to get over. So in 2 weeks, if a person can break down and get into depression, the future is very blur for such people. I would like to share one a small case that came. So what we did was IFBA now, currently, I'll just tell you what IFBA is doing right now. Currently, we are just transferring money into the account. It's a very difficult task that we are doing. We are around 9 of us. Plus, we've hired 2 more telecallers who are calling people up and asking them, you know, how bad the situation is. And if and when they need some counseling, we call them. Like a couple of our members call them up and speak to them. Because right now, for them, the best thing that one can do is to hear them out. They don't have any options. They look like they are alone. So what we do is we try to counsel them. This is one situation I would like to share is that which actually opened our eyes and we could gauge the situation, how bad it is for some of us, is when one of the guys who sent us a message via WhatsApp and said that, please, if you can't help me, let me know. There was some delay in the payment because one of our guys has to go to the bank and deposit the money every time, you know. Because of the lockdown, we had to take police permission and all that stuff. So it was one day delay. We couldn't transfer the amount. And then he sent a message saying that, if you can help me, please tell me. If you can't, then I'm going to suicide. And we were like shocked because this message came at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we were all asleep. So in the morning, 6 o'clock, I got a call from Pankaj. And he was saying like, this is like really bad. So we saw his case. He has around 22 years of experience. He's been working abroad. And he has a daughter who's 7 years old. And he's living with his parents. So I would say a very hardcore hotelier. And he's coming to this situation. So we spoke to him. We tried to give him some ideas. Try to work out a strategy. Try to get all the positive points. And we tried to deviate his attention from, you know, the current situation. The only fear was that it's only 2 weeks. And we do not know what is going to happen even when the lockdown opens, you know. We do not know what is the situation of the industry. So, we talked him out of it. Next day, we transferred the amount. We're still in touch with him. But I'm telling you, if an educated guy with 22 years of experience, you know, can think of such drastic steps in just 2 weeks, I wonder what will be the situation of people who don't have a voice, who don't have any bank balance, who have like 4 to 5 dependents on them, you know. And some of them are so lonely now, like Shalini ma'am just said. We are lucky that we are with our family, and you know, we are keeping ourselves busy in whatever way we can. But there are people who can't go back home. They have small kids. Their wives are pregnant. Their parents are sick. And I'm telling you that the list goes on and on. I can just go on because there's nobody to hear them out. So IFBA, as a association, thought let's address them because the entire industry is doing a commendable job of kind of keeping everybody busy, finding activities to motivate them, sharing knowledge, you know, giving chat shows where mentors are talking about, you know, things that you can do and keep yourself busy. But on the contrary, there are a lot of other industrial professionals, industry professions, or friends of the trade who kind of are not in the situation to do anything like that. They just want to get out of the situation by just getting a meal. We had a case where, yeah, there's some cases which are really, really bad. And I'm talking about hospitality industry, leave alone the rest of all the other industries. So our main attention right now, like IFBA, is totally concentrating on all of these cases. So we are like around. Plus, and all our efforts are to kind of, you know, help all of these guys. So that's what we are doing right now.
Thank you, Rohan. And this is the kind of situation that even we don't know that this lockdown is will be over by 3rd May even. It may go beyond that. The kind that of is a, that is a, news we are getting from inside the administration. So,
ma'am, I think right now the only tool to keep everybody focused is, like Mr. Lama also said, you know, is to have mental strength, because people are breaking down eventually. That was 2 weeks for that guy. Trust me, it is all going to come to us also. If at all the laws changes, if at all there's any kind of, yesterday I read something about someone is trying to kind of ban alcohol in India. I know it's a rumor, but imagine if such things happen, you know, the kind of impact it will create to all of us. We'll slowly get there. I mean, we are not in the position right now where we, you know, we need to have some mental strength. Yes, we do in a bit, but eventually it is coming up to us as well. So I only think that right now, the only way that we can kind of go through this situation is to have that mental strength.
Yeah, and that's why our whole idea was to collect all of you together to say some words of wisdom to your community. They would listen to it and they will, I think, will be out from the depression. That was the whole idea. So, and very good initiative, Rohan. Let me congratulate you. And now we move over to Sandy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Sandy. So, as I said initially that you have created a lots of venues for the bartending community to start the business. Mm-hmm. right? So I know, and I will I would want to know from you that what are you doing right now for the bartending community, and can you guide them once the lockdown is over, what are you going to, what can they do after this pandemic is over?
Okay, ma'am. I see the two aspects. Now, what we did was initially when the COVID happened, we analyzed the situation. When you analyze, we know what are the repercussions which are going to happen in due time to come. So what we did was, if it's a long lockdown or a short lockdown, we had prepared ourselves. So first things first, we, when everybody was, when this lockdown happened, so everybody had to disperse. First of all, we made arrangements for our internal team to start with. So we bought a house in Valley View itself, where we have just rented out an apartment. So whoever is stuck and cannot go back home, we organized beds and we organized all the facilities, including the washing machines and ovens and everything. And we fulfilled it. We shifted few people. There was somebody from Kolkata and there was one guy from Indore in our team. They could not go back home. So first thing sorted that they don't have to live alone and in a depression. The other thing we did was, in case, because I live nearby, food is required, I can cook it at home and supply it to them. So that thing was sorted, first of all. Then we made a plan and where we thought not mentoring, but coaching will be the thing. When the depression happens, there's two things. The one is the fear of the unknown. And the other one is, how am I going to make money and survive right now? And the third is psychological impacts and emotional impacts. So as we made a plan, as Lama had said earlier, and even Rohan supported that, we made a plan of a day routine and we came on the web and we actually started doing pranayam, or not, meditation is a very heavy word for these guys. So what we started was cool down. We made a WhatsApp group. We sent a relaxing music and for 5 to 10 minutes, everybody had to do breathing exercises to concentrate on the breathing. So that relaxes you. First of all, that relaxes you and calms you down. The other approach was, now what the situation is, what's going to happen, let's not talk about it. What we can do right now is, I'm not going to give you a fish so that you're fed for a day. I'm going to teach you how to fish so you can come through it. So we started coaching these people and we gave them some assignments. The reason was to motivate them and engage them. So once they're motivated slightly, they engaged, their mind is diverted on doing some assignments. So we made a work from home policy where they had to input 6 hours of a day definitely. And there was a day plan given, which I'd shared on the Excel sheet with everybody. So they had to fill that. What are they going to do? So we did one-to-one sessions on coaching. What were their strengths and what were their weaknesses? And what do they see and what do they fear? Once we had the answers, so we got the common concerns and we started addressing them. So through webinars, we approached those things and we started laying down the foundation for them. Foundation of what we can do from here and the values. So once this happens, they become stronger. So they're meditating in the morning, they're getting to know about the foundation, and then the whole game was explained to them what our game plan is and how we're going to approach it for the next 8 months. Our business is recession proof, it's going to come back. It's a matter of 8 to 10 months and how we're going to survive during 8 to 10 months. So once you put a capping to the problem, they start looking for solutions. So we pushed them to find the solutions. What were the strengths and what were the weaknesses? So a lot of weaknesses, we started helping them to work. So 90% of the staff said, English is weak. So we started guiding them on English. We started going on YouTube, giving them this thing, links, where to go. We started approaching on recipe management and techniques, go on the videos and get into those webinars. The industry is doing it every day. So this was engagement. Once the engagement happens, they are more motivated. They start developing themselves. So the next step was, they are, once they are developed to a little extent also, maybe 1%, 2%, 3%, the drive comes up. The light comes back to them and they feel empowered there. So once they feel empowered, the stress levels go down. Then we made a game plan, which we shared. We said it might not be that we will work on this, but it's like the life has rebooted right now. So you have a phone or you have a this thing, we format everything and we start from again.
the advantage we have is here. Now, I being 52, so I motivate them that at the age of 52, I'm not worried. Why are you guys worried? And I've got all of you families to look after. So you have to lead from the front. And I said, the life is rebooted. We don't know. When I started my career at the age of 19, I didn't know what I'm going to do. I didn't even know whether I would get into bartending, which happened by luck. But I was raring to go to explore life. And that's where we are standing today, at ground zero, to explore what's going to happen. The curves will change. The revenue management will change. The revenue earnings will change. The streams will change. Right now, they've dried up. But same thing happened to me when I passed out in 1990. The Kuwait war had happened and the jobs were dried up. So for me, and I've done a lot of businesses, and not everybody's been every business has been successful. So I have been groomed by luck or default or by whatever the fortune. I've been fortunate enough that I've bounced back again and again. So first thing you need is a mental strength. Then you need to strategize. So we are at a reboot situation, ground zero, but we have an experience of whatever number of years we have worked. So we are much more smarter than the age of 19 to approach this situation.
Right.
Now all we need to do is strategize and work forward. So I've given them a few options for what people can do. Even the simple thing, how to increase their capability of garnish cutting, or maybe know about shrubs, the small little things. So knowledge develops them, it empowers them, they feel that they have achieved something. And in the evening, we again discuss. Secondly, we have a session between 6 to 7, which is counseling. Anybody can call me. And not only from the industry, people from other walks of life are also calling me up. They're discussing. There's another gentleman called Rajiv Aneja. Might know him. So we've discussed. I've shared his number also to people who want to talk. We are a very positive bend of people. So we have offered a service to counsel people, and people are saying kya hoga. We don't know kya hoga, but definitely earth is not coming to an end. It's that the economic system is a failure right now, but it will revive. It's a consumer market, so consumer behaviors have to be again aggregated, and it will revive. People will not stop drinking, people will not stop drinking or eating, so they will come back. Formats might change. If it's not a restaurant, a cloud kitchen will come in. If it's not a bartending and a wedding, people will socialize. It's their need to socialize. So they will start doing it at home. So what can we do to work at the home bars? How we can improve ourselves there? So there's a stream there, and they understand that if I'm coming, and then I'm scaring them also. I said, now tomorrow, 5-star hotels will start coming into the homes. They will start catering to them. So you need to be better than a 5-star employee. And they have the resources from laundry to everything, training. So you need to be, up your game. And that the charge, the motivated. So yes, this is how we see it. Then a lot of bartenders are doing online programs, so which gives a lot of avenues and opportunities to start your digital online courses. And I guess half of us would be thinking about that. So and that's a brilliant platform. And then it comes to marketing. So all you need to do is drive yourself, and I think we'll bounce back. The human beings are adaptable. They've adapted to every situation. It's just that the biggest dampener is your own fear, nothing else. Rest, everything will open up. So the first things first, and I would recommend everybody in this group, go the Lama way. Let's meditate in the morning. It calms you down.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. But you rightly said, I received the communique from hotel, 5-star hotel Pullman, and they started home delivery. At a very economical price. Yeah. So that's what people price. Are doing right now.
So it's price sensitive market, and you need to up your game.
Yeah.
You should be the first choice for a customer.
Yeah.
Today he wants more in the value of money.
And if somebody gets a genuine hygienic food at the rate of kind of a 375 or something from Pullman, everybody will go for it. Thank you, Sandy.
So we got to learn. We need to be as hygienic as them or better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So now, Arjun, we come to you. And as you traveled a lot, I know, with Bacardi also, and after that also, you have been in Singapore for a long period. So I want to know that since you have been interacting a lot of people abroad also, and we are reading and hearing that lots of things are going to be changed after this pandemic is over. Like the way we do business will be changed.
Yeah.
The way we interact with people will be changed. In the behavior of people, it's going to change. So there are lots of things are going to be changed in the coming period, coming time. So you tell me what kind of business scenario will be for the bar industry and bartending community?
So it's that's a complicated question, but in agreement with what a lot has been said before, I always walk into conversations like this with a caveat that humans are resilient, right? Yes, businesses will change. We will walk into a new world, but this is not the first time this has happened. We have had pandemics before. We have had earthquakes before. One of my favorite examples is Japan, right? Japan was always riddled with earthquakes. They thought they're going to die, typhoons, so on and so forth. But Japan, as of now, has the best calamity action program. Like every kid from the time that they're grown, they're taught if an earthquake comes, what you're supposed to do. That comes not through times of peace. That comes through going through aggravated periods, right? Okay. This is the first time as educated Indians we have had to face this. So we will come out on the other side a lot smarter, a lot more intelligent, a lot more resilient than we have been, right? It's not business another day. But as we go through it, we are going to figure out how to navigate our way to how our life was before. Right, then we will get hit with another calamity. That is the scenario. That's one of the things that I believe and helps me look at things a little bit more positive. The second thing is, no matter how you look at it, no matter how bad your situation or your friend's situation is, there are 10 people going through worse scenarios. We are sitting in our rooms. We are perfectly safe. We are freaking telling people how to make cocktails. Right? That's how frivolous we are. Right? We are not. So do you understand what I'm saying? It's all fun and games, but nobody's teaching me how to grow onions during this time. People are telling me how to make a great drink with a freaking rum or use coffee, which to me is both a good thing and a bad thing. As we move ahead, different countries are going through different scenarios. I generally don't feel that bartenders have got the brunt of it. Some of us, yes, but look at bigger businesses, right? I am part of the whole liquor industry and liquor production. I'm part of we had business plans. All of it has died down, right? The only country I'm existing in properly is Singapore and Taiwan because of the way they kind of handled it. And I'm talking to their guys. They are operating with their understanding, right? A lot of them say there are five. They stay in like how people stay in Bombay, right? Five people in a single room, right? But compared to that, we have a little bit more space.
Yes.
Right, we can sit in a room alone and kids are not walking around. So yeah, things are super, super difficult. We possibly do not know what's going to happen. But what we will need to prepare for is, let's say, like it was mentioned before, right? Business is going to change.
Yeah.
Our business, what we guys do and what you're asking us about bartenders, our business is B2B. It is dependent on venues and outlets. Alcohol is dependent on venues and those venues need to survive. So a lot of it depends on how those venues will react to this.
Yeah.
For example, there's Trump got a very bad rep for saying it. He said that the owners will change, which is true. A lot of businesses will change hands, but businesses will remain. The number of covers which are there in a venue will change because, for example, Mr. Lama would know this, right? He's for whatever covers that they're operating with, it was all calculated on a business plan based on 18 months of return on investment. You're paying rent. Those business plans are not going to make sense anymore because you have to create more distances, which means you will have lesser staff. You will have lesser people to get hired.
Yeah, so which and are lesser, all, lesser tables.
Lesser and tables, outlet. Yeah.
So
we are going to go back to drinking how it was in the 1990s or maybe earlier.
Earlier.
Right? Absolutely. All those people for the first few months are not going to spend money. So when all the brilliant rums and whiskeys that we are talking about, they are not going to sell for the first 6-7 months. So those businesses will die. I was talking to somebody in Jakarta. They run Ismaya Group. He was ill. He was in his room and he's saying, I'm dying because I'm trying to figure out how to pay 4,000 people for the next 3 months. That's the number of people who work in the unit. Can you imagine the amount of pressure? He's with his family and stuff, but can you imagine the amount of pressure that he has on his on himself to figure it out?
Yeah.
So people will have to be fired. I mean, things are the way they are. What bartenders and we guys should be happy about is we don't have that much pressure on our heads. So wake up every morning, look at the world in a good light, take care of yourself and those around you, chill a little bit, don't take so much pressure that I have to do videos, I have to do training, I have to exercise, right? World's given us a chance to recharge. So I think look at it that way and that will kind of help. In terms of liquor business in itself, will take a huge hit. The big brands will come back and survive. The small craft brands will get screwed.
True.
Which is the situation, and they will have to circumnavigate. So those are all there. Before I end this, there's this guy that I follow called Gary Vaynerchuk. He was a wine retailer in New York. He made his money on being the first guy who was selling wine online. Okay. And he's rich enough to buy a baseball or a basketball team. He wrote a book called Jab Jab Hook Hook, and
he
always said that to survive, always have a side hustle. Right, you've got to figure out how to things for your main line of job. Things can always go bad. Like an MBA in engineering, none of that is helping now. Whoever saved money, that money can't help them now because they can't spend it anywhere. So I have followed that for the last 3-4 years, always had little side hustles which have been going down, which used to be looked at in a bad light before, because side hustle meant that you're not giving your main job enough attention. But if you can do it, you create other baskets, you make other eggs as you go forward. When we come out on the other side, you make sure there's some amount of money always parked aside, or you have other avenues. You learn skills, not just particular to your industry. I love bartending, and this is the only thing I think I'll do for the rest of my life, but I can't do it 6 days a week. That's why I want to get into liquor industry or education part of it. Education will never die. Hospitality will never die. They will always come back. They have survived for thousands of years,
right?
It will all come back. So you always create those side hustles so that you have some amount of money that's there and you don't have to depend on other people, which would be my one advice. So, and I follow that guy really well. So find all of these mentors and inspirational guys. And for different people, it's different things, right? Mr. Lama would look at it differently. Shadbi ma'am would look at it differently. Rohan has a different outlook. So we have all different ways of handling it. The bartenders who listen, pick up bits and pieces from all of us and modulate your own way to survive. Nobody's there to help you. You got to do it yourself, right? You survive, you become stronger. And if you do survive well, on the other side, you will become a very strong professional.
The sun is on the other side of the wall right now.
Always, yeah.
Thank you, Arijit. And thank you. Yeah.
Sorry, just to add on to, you know, this thing that just struck my head.
Yeah.
You know, you asked me that question about how do you take care of yourself? You know, let's look at it this way. What makes you unhappy, you know, as human beings? What is it that brings sadness to us mentally? It's always when we look at somebody who is above us.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, and it's a usual thing, even in a normal lives, you know, what happens is, we can never be at peace. You know, that's a typical human tendency. You earn 10 rupees, you want to earn 20. You have a fancy car, you want to earn a fancier car. You know, that's what also leads to unhappiness.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, at this point in time, it's also a thought process. You know, let's look at people who are deprived, like because I also work very closely with my community here and back home. So, you know, there are lots of people in Gurgaon. So people who work in houses and, you know, domestic help. In the last 20 days, there have been at least 20 to 30 calls that's come to me from people I don't even know where they got the number from. And there are people who are saying that I have 2 children, you know, I used to run this Momo stall somewhere. I don't have money. My owner has vanished. So things like that. And it's very depressing. Then the only thing that I ask them is, look, I also can't move, but do you have a store near you who can provide you rice? And they say, yes. Then I transfer a little bit of money. I said, okay, this much, will it help cater to, you know, at least get your dry stuff. So what happens is, when you look at that, at least you should be thankful that for us, even if the lockdown goes up for the next couple of months, we can still survive, even for bartenders. And always, I've always advised people that listen, you cannot spend all your money. Most of the bartenders who work in cities like Delhi and Mumbai and Bangalore are people who come from smaller areas, you know, so they both pay for their rent, they pay for their food, beverage, all of that. And I always said, at least learn how to save money, because in our country, the problem is, tomorrow if you're in a difficult situation, nobody's going to help you. You need to learn how to survive. And therefore, that little bit of saving will give you that confidence. You know, it's very important. So I think the first and the foremost is to look at people who are deprived of all these things, and that will probably give you that mental strength to stay afloat. You know, that's very important.
Yeah.
Can I just add one thing to what Mr. Lama just said? The other part of that we never really realize is, for a lot of bartenders, I'm being specific to bartenders and issues that they have around the world, that tips are a major part around the world for bartenders, specifically in places like US and stuff. Right, India tips are not that high. Singapore tips are the lowest. Japan, nobody tips. It's seen as a bad thing to tip people unless you're really, really close to them, unless they are influenced by an American style. So largely for the world, bartending was a unregulated profession. Right, but over the last 15, 20 years, what's happening is bartenders are coming into the forefront. They are becoming like experts.
Not like 15, 20 years, Arijit. I think 12 years at max.
No, you're looking at India. I'm looking at
India.
More.
Yeah.
More. India has been last five. India, I think the my yardstick. Years. Yeah, my yardstick for anything is when the consumers take up those jobs, right?
Yeah.
So till 2015, consumers did not really look at. Now everyone's a bartender. Everyone's doing videos. But till 2015, that was super limited.
Yeah,
this was limited to people like us, who this is all that we had, right? But outside, it's been happening for some time. USA, because of their speakeasy business kind of elevated, and the way they look at food and beverage plus craft spirits, bartenders in US just realized that they were earning a lot of unorganized tip money, which was their livelihood. But when a calamity happens and the government has to give you money, it's based on what your official document or payslip says.
True.
Right?
True.
So it's both good, it's both bad. So hence, London bartenders survived it. India bartenders, if we ever had any injection going into them, they would survive because it's on a payslip. Mm-hmm. So as we move out, tips are going to become more and more redundant. And more of us are going to come into the whole organized sector, which will take time, but will improve the industry in a way, the way I see it.
Right.
Right. People will not be mercenaries anymore. And the moment you do that, then bartending and the bartending industry will become a valid profession, not just a vocation, if you know what I mean. So that's the second change that you will see in India. What you will see happen now is sanitation is going to become really big. We have been talking about it forever. I discuss this with Pankaj every day. If you want to bartend in Canada, you have to go through a 8-hour exam for responsible service. Same for Australia. In Singapore, if I wanted to bartend, I have to go through a 6-hour. We have nothing like that in India. Where specifically things are the most unhygienic. Like, I was in Bombay for 7 years. I have been on those trains and I have seen people use irrigation for mint leaves. Right, the same people are making sandwiches in the evening, so we generally don't stay clean. I think when we come out of here, sanitation is going to become a big thing, and it's going to become official that you do, and hand sanitizers have to be there, like the kitchen used to do it. The bar is going to see that, and I see that as an advantage. Anyway, sorry, just wanted to add that.
Thanks a lot. And what I collected from all of you, Sandy is not here. So Shadvi said ki, we should develop something as our hobby in these times. I just want to show you one thing. Just wait.
Shalini, I hope it's not a poll that's going to come up. That's good.
So this was my hobby. I created this flower vase with a wine bottle.
Oh, nice.
So this was my hobby, but I couldn't do it because of my work. But this is the time I am utilizing with my art and craft work. So
the point I was also making, Shalini, is not only to develop hobbies, but to look at that hobby to see how you can cultivate that into a business plan as well.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Like Arijit said, don't put all your eggs in one basket.
Exactly. It's a plan B. It's a kind of business, art and craft business. If I ever want to do, correct, I can do it. I didn't have time.
You're looking at it wrong. Make them into mixing glasses. All the bartenders will buy it.
I will do it.
I'll buy it.
I have made it, Arijit, but right now I don't have the complete solution with me right now. So I'm going to buy it after this lockdown is over and I'll make it. At least all of five of you, at least I'll present it to you. Okay.
We'll buy it for sure.
No, not buy. I'll gift it to you.
We have to. That's the only way you'll get it into a business if we buy it.
Next time.
No, we should buy it and the fund should go to IFBA.
Did you ever watch the movie Batman? Dark Knight Rises. Joker came out. He said, if you're good at something, don't do it for free.
Free, yeah. I am gonna to do for my friends, not for the consumers. So Shadvi rightly said, and the same way Arjit said that we should create a side hustler, right? Sandy has advised a lot of things for being busy in this in these times, difficult times, to utilize for educating ourselves, for garnishing, for other things as well. And Rohan apprised us about the initiative, what he is doing right now. And Yangdup has suggested a lot of things to us, but I request Yangdup one thing, and I am great fan of you in this regard. You are a very spiritual personality you have. So I want you to chant something right now with all our viewers. Please do it.
You know, when we were talking to our employees on one of those sessions.
Yeah.
And we were having this discussion. I said, it's not a, you know, spiritual practice is a completely different thing. So it's something that you do it over a period of time.
Suddenly
abhi lockdown aaya to sara shuru karte. It does not happen that way.
No, it's
basically like a habit. You know, you get into it, then
it's my habit. I chant something different, but I want to listen from you.
So there are many chants, but I'll just do the most common, which is the Om Mani Padme Hum, you know, which means, basically, chants are nothing. Chants are simply about, the more you keep chanting, your concentration becomes better. And those are supposed to be, and you always chant with the right pronunciation. So what it does is it's supposed to create a lot of positivity, you know, and then it helps to concentrate. So your mind becomes more refreshing. You know, the longer you chant over a period of time, it kind of disconnects you for a moment and you rediscover yourself. So it just, you know, you come out of it. Usually in our lives, we are very, very, you know, especially the kind of life that we live in a city like Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, where, you know, it's at a very fast pace. We miss out on simpler things. The idea at the end of the day is, you know, what we need is simplicity, you know, and that we need to be contented with certain things, be thankful and be happy. At the end of the day, you know, for whatever we've done, however the day goes, you've got to be happy. And that's very important, you know.
Sure.
I think that is... that is what we all seek at the end of the day, you know, whether it's an animal, whether it's a human being, all that we need at the end of the day is just a little bit of happiness, you know, and that's why we all try to strive and do whatever we do to achieve that. And so, you know, this is one simple way of helping it.
Right.
And so I usually, what I do is I chant the Om Mani Padme Hum. And it's very simple. It's like, I do it, sometimes in a, you know, when I have all the time in the world and I like now, then I do it in a longer phase where I stress it a little bit, you know, fine tune. Otherwise, during busy hours, I do it quickly, you know, like Om Mani Padme. So you got to be practical as well. Okay, so I'll just do the longer method just for you. So, oh. Krishna.
So thank you all for sparing some time for Spirits Studio, and we'll connect again. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye, everyone.
Yeah.